The Olympic 800-meter final. Arzhinov of Russia, lane 1. Dieter from East Germany, lane 2. Wattler's in lane 3. Lane 4, Uko, the Commonwealth champion from Kenya. Lane 5, Carter, Great Britain. Lane 6, Kemper of West Germany. Lane 7, Mike Voigt of Kenya. And lane 8, Kupchik of Poland. And Arzhinov has gone off very quickly and now slows down to make sure of the position. And coming right across from the outside is Mike Voigt, the Kenyan 1500-meter runner. And Uko, his teammate, has gone on the inside and the two Kenyans lead. It's Mike Voigt leading for Kenya. In second place is Uko of Kenya. Right up on the outside is Andy Carter, who's got such a positive and bold attitude towards the two-lap race. And right at the back is Dave Wattle, who got left way, way behind. Still the two Kenyans with the Briton up there in front. And it's Uko now coming up to take it up. And Voigt holds the curve. Uko right alongside him. The Kenyans running shoulder to shoulder, making the rest go wide. Andy Carter there at the bell, 52.3 the time. A modest time in many ways. And Dieter from East Germany goes up the long way on the outside. It's still the Kenyans. Voigt and Uko lead. Running absolutely stride for stride and shoulder to shoulder. Uko there on the curve, Voigt on the outside. Dieter from going up now to third place. And Arzhinov, the European champion, comes through from the back for Russia. Arzhinov now hits the front for the two Africans, with Dieter from going as well, and Wattles improving all the time, and Carter next to last. 200 metres left. It's still the Russian Arzhinov leading. And coming up on the outside now is Uko, the Commonwealth champion. The European champion versus the Commonwealth champion, and Voigt is there, and the American there too. Arzhinov kicks for home. A tremendous piece of power by the Russian. And Wattles coming on the near side. What a finish this is. Arzhinov stumbling and Voigt coming through. Wattle gave them 10 yards, way behind the field, and did he win? I think he did.
We're still in our Live Loud series. We're in section 7 of it right now. And this part is about finishing strong. And I've got a little quick video here for you. I'll kind of preface it a little bit. The American is in the baseball cap.
Take it up. And Voigt holds the curve.
All right, you know, I've watched that video 100 times now, and every time I get goosebumps from it. What an amazing athlete David Waddle was. You know, that pack left him. The Russian that was leading that race, he was the favorite to win it. And then you've got two Kenyans up there. Now, those guys are built for running. He dropped back, but he didn't give up. He kept driving forward. He kept pulling that inner self of himself there. And as he started making headway there, he realized, hey, I might have a chance here. And he just kept driving. He didn't quit. He kept pushing for that finish line. And he finished strong. Just like each one of us can finish strong in our daily lives. God has a plan for us. When we were born, he laid out a finish line for us. Now, we have, at times, being humans, strayed from that path. And God has ways of kind of nudging us back to where he wants us. Sometimes he'll redirect us, but he still gets us that same finish line that he had set for us before. So today, our story, we're going to cover Samson. Samson was a guy who finished strong. Samson's life is found in the book of Judges, chapter 13 through 16. Now, we don't have enough time to go through all that today, so what we'll do, I'll give you a little brief summary over him. Samson's parents were childless, and the angel of the Lord came to him and said, hey, you're going to have a son. And he's going to be set apart for the Lord. And this set apart, he'll be a Nazarite. And what that means is that his life is dedicated to the Lord. And there are certain things that go with that. Nazarites don't cut their hair. A razor is never to touch their head. This is a symbol of that world that they are dedicated to the Lord. A few other things, they're not allowed to consume any products that are made from grapes. And that'd be it, you know, the grape itself, grape juice, wine, raisins, anything like that. They're not allowed to consume that. Also, they're not allowed to come in contact with a dead body. Now, this could be even their parents, they're not allowed to come in contact with them. So if they should happen to, what happens is they have to shave their head and they go through a 7-day cleansing process, and then they start their dedication over. Now, Samson's parents, like I say, dedicated him from birth. As Samson grew up, and he got stronger, his hair grew longer, and Samson kind of had an eye for the ladies. He didn't always make the best choices for women in his life. He spied a young lady, a Philistine lady, and he saw her outward beauty, but he didn't take time to look at her heart. As a Philistine lady, or as a Philistine, she was an enemy of the Hebrew people. At the time, the Philistines were actually ruling over the Hebrews. So Samson didn't take time to get to know her heart. And that's a good lesson right there within itself for all of us as we look at future spouses, boyfriends, girlfriends that we're dating. We need to take time to look at the people's heart. So, like I say, Samson fell in love with this Philistine lady, Delilah. And Delilah didn't really have a true heart for Samson. And there were, at the time, there were five Philistine leaders in the area. And they came to Delilah and said, if you'll help us figure out how to subdue Samson, we'll give you 1,100 shekels of silver apiece. Now that works out to about $48,000. Now how many of you women would sell your husband for $48,000? Oh, never mind, don't raise, no, please. But honestly, you know, $48,000 is what she was gonna sell Samson for. So she agreed. Three times Delilah tried to find out Samson's secret of his great strength. Because see, Samson was an enemy of the Philistine people. He had killed thousands of them. Matter of fact, at one incident, with just the jawbone of a donkey, he killed 1,000 men, stacked them up like cordwood. So he was an enemy. Three times she tried to figure out how to subdue him. And three times Samson, he told her maybe not quite the truth. Well, let's just really face it. Samson lied to her. He didn't tell her what the secret was to his great strength. And finally, she broke out the big guns. She said the words that every husband hate to hear. You don't love me. You won't tell me the secret of your hair. You don't love me. Now guys, we all know we don't like to hear our wife say that. So finally Samson gave in and he told her the secret of his hair. Or excuse me, secret of his strength. Kind of gave it away there. But, anyway, told her the secret of his strength. So that night while he's sleeping, Delilah takes a razor and shaves his head. Now, I don't know how good you got to be sleeping for somebody to cut your hair at night while you're sleeping, but Samson must have been out. Kind of reminds me of one time, I like to wear my hair short. One day I thought, you know what? I'll shave my head. I will never forget the look on my wife's face when she walked through that door and saw my head shaved. And the first words out of her mouth, don't ever, ever do that again. You know, some guys got pretty heads. I mean, they're nice and smooth. I do not. Mine's, yeah. Looks like the mountains out west. So I was told never do that again. So Delilah cut Samson's hair, and the Philistines rush in, and they subdue him. They gouge his eyes out, and they take him as a prisoner and make him a slave. Now, the Philistines are excited about this because now they've just captured their greatest enemy. So they're going to have a big celebration. They're at their temple and they're going to celebrate and give praise and worship to their god, Dagon. Well, in the middle of this celebration, you know, they're drinking, they're singing, they're dancing, they're having a great time. Someone says, hey, bring out Samson, let him entertain us. So they call him up from the prison, and the young man that's bringing him up from prison is helping him along because he's blind. And Samson is praying to the Lord the whole time, Lord, give me my strength just one more time, one more time. So they bring him into the temple, and there's about 3,000 Philistine, we'll say, influential people there at the time, besides all the leaders and their families. This young man takes Samson in. He says, could you put me by the two support pillars so I can brace myself because I can't see? He said, sure. So he sets him up next to these pillars. And Samson puts his hands on these two support pillars in a giant temple. And with all his strength, he shoves. And this temple begins to quake. And as that temple falls down upon him and these Philistines, he just cries out, Lord, let me die with the Philistines. Samson did his greatest work right there at the end of his life. He cried out to the Lord to give him strength. Samson finished well. All right, so we can start with our first slide. How we start makes a difference in how we finish. And this comes from Judges 13. He will be dedicated to God as a Nazarite from birth. You know, how many of us knew where we would be 15 years ago How many of you knew that you would be in Winnemac, Indiana? I'll be honest with you, 15 years ago, I didn't even know where Winnemac, Indiana is. I never even heard of it. Honestly, Indiana was where the Indy 500 was. That's all I knew about Indiana. You know, how many of us knew where we'd be financially, or in our education, or in our married life? You know, I'm a Southern boy. I never dreamed that I would be married to a girl from Chicago. But thank God that the Lord changed my path and brought her into my life. Before I knew the Lord's plan for me, I always had my own little plan. You know, I had dreams, things that I wanted to do, places I wanted to go. I'll be honest with you, I always thought that I would be a professional race car driver. I loved drag racing. I grew up with guys like Bob Glidden, Kenny Bernstein, Don Prudhomme, and some of you younger guys don't even have a clue who those guys are, but that's who I grew up. And I just knew one day I'd be standing there next to them. But that wasn't the path that God had for me. He laid out a different path for me. And so now, I'm excited to see what the Lord has for me. You know, I tried it my way for all these years, and it didn't work out. They would come close, but they never were completely fulfilled. So I'm looking forward now to seeing what God has for me, has in store for me. All right, our next slide. We must train hard to finish strong. And this comes from Judges 13:24. The Spirit of the Lord began to stir in him. Now, God started to stir in Samson things that he wanted in him. He knew that Samson needed to know him better, to be able to just talk with him. He knew that there were things that Samson needed to learn to get closer to him. You know, just like an athlete, we have to train every day. You know, David Waddle didn't go out there a week before the Olympics and say, you know what, I think I'm going to run the 800. No, he trained for years. And the way we do that training ourselves is we spend time in our Bible. You know, we sit down and we read for a few minutes. I'll be honest with you, the hardest thing in the world for me, used to be and still is at times, was to find time to read my Bible. Now, I had plenty of time to sit down and watch the Cubs play baseball, or I had plenty of time to watch somebody in a drag race, or my favorite TV show was on. I could sit down there for hours and watch that, but I couldn't find 10 or 15 minutes to spend with the Lord. And I've found that the more I have done it, the more I want it. And I'm just going to give a little plug right here. If you have an iPhone, the greatest app you can have on your phone is that Bible app. Every day, it takes me about 20 minutes to drive to work every day. I can turn this thing on, and I can have that app will read to me scripture. So I encourage you, if you don't have it, if you don't know how to get it on your phone, come to me afterwards, come to Dawn. We'll help you on that. That thing is just amazing. And to continue talking about what we need to do to train ourselves, we need to be leaders in our workplace. You know, take an active role. I've been a mechanic my whole life, been around mechanics my whole life. And we'll say the language around there sometimes gets a little rough. Well, by not buying into that trap, I'm training myself. And other people notice this too, and you're having an effect on their life just by that simple act right there. I'm not buying into that trap. And probably the last thing I'd like to say here, probably the most important thing, spending time in prayer with the Lord. This helps train us. It helps us to hear His voice when He speaks to us. I sit and spend some time usually by myself praying. But I'll say this right now for couples. The biggest change I ever saw in my prayer life was when Dawn and I started praying together. When we go to bed at night, it's the last thing we do. And it doesn't have to be any elaborate thing. Just thank the Lord for the day, asking for a good night's sleep. But we pray together, and then before we get up in the morning, we thank the Lord for that night, and we thank the Lord for each other. And that was the biggest change I ever saw in my prayer life right there. So I encourage you to take just a few minutes to do that with your spouse each day. All right, our next slide. We must have a great team around us to finish strong. This comes from Judges 16:4. Sometime later, Samson fell in love with a woman named Delilah, who lived in the village of Sorek. Now, kind of like we've talked about before, Delilah was a Philistine, and the Philistines were the enemy of the Hebrews. And actually, to this day, they're still enemies of the Hebrew people. The modern-day Palestinians that you hear about, those are the descendants of the Philistines. And you hear today the Palestinians, suicide bombers, rocket attacks, things like that. So they are still enemies to this day. You know, back in World War II, we didn't go to the Japanese and say, hey, could you build us some planes for this war? We didn't go to the Germans and say, hey, could you build us some tanks? Why didn't we do that? Because they were our enemies. So that's the thing. You've got to be careful who you have around you. Surround yourself with good Christian people who love and care about you. And I'm talking truly care about you. Because you can tell when someone's being just kind of surface. People who want to see you standing in heaven. Those are the people you want to surround yourself with. All right, our next slide. We finish strong by refusing to give in. This comes from Judges 16:18. She tormented him with her nagging day after day until he was sick to death of it. Now, I'm not going to ask. No, don't raise hands. I'm not asking who. But, you know, it's not only our spouse that nags at us. It's the world, honestly. You know, that daily grind, the way it just tries to tear us down. Especially, I'm going to tell you right now, if you let them know you're a Christian, it is going to come after you. It will. But, you know, that job, that boss who just is never satisfied or never happy with that, you can't let him drag you down. So you have to surround yourself, and you have to finish, you have to refuse to quit. You have to just keep pushing through. Now, the Bible is full of stories of great people who wouldn't quit. You know, what if Noah gets halfway through the boat project, says, Lord, it's too much. I'm done. You know, my sons are here helping me. Nobody from town's coming here to help me. It's just too much. But he didn't. He knew the Lord was going to help him see that project through. He trusted in that. You know, what about Moses? I can just see Moses walking in there in front of Pharaoh in his best Charlton Heston voice. Pharaoh, let my people go. And I can see Pharaoh sitting there, arms crossed. Go, no. Did Moses just go, oh, okay, I guess not, and just walk off and give up? No, he knew the Lord had his back. He refused to quit. He kept pushing forward. And the last one I want to bring up here is Jesus. You know, in the Garden of Gethsemane, he could have very easily said, Father, this cross is too much. I can't do this. You're asking too much of me. They committed the sins. Let them pay for it. But he didn't. He kept pushing forward. Kept doing what the Father had asked him. And he stayed strong and he turned it over to the Father's hands. Now, I want to tell you guys a quick personal story here. I don't know if some of you guys may not be old enough to know the show Golden Girls. Yeah. My wife loves this show. And I've sat around and watched it with her. And, there was a lady on there, Sophia Petrillo, little Italian immigrant lady, and she loved to tell stories. And she always started them off the same, so that's how I'm going to start my story off today. Picture this. 1981, Memphis, Tennessee, Raleigh Egypt High School, number 37, 6'2", 120 pounds soaking wet, Glenn Williamson. So I played high school football, and down south we have what's called a jamboree every year at the beginning of football season. What it is, two teams come together, you play for 15 minutes. So, just so happened, we were slated to play Hamilton High School. Team was picked to win the AAA football championship for the state of Tennessee that year. So we got there, we played these guys, and we play hard. We're giving it our best, our very best. And at the end of 15 minutes, you look up there at that scoreboard, and it was 31-0. They drove us into the ground. 15 minutes, they beat us 31-0. So let's fast forward 3 months later, and we're happening to play Hamilton High School the very last game of the season. Hamilton High School is undefeated. We come in there, first quarter, 0-0. Hey, we're liking that. Second quarter, we get down, a minute left to go in the quarter. Hamilton High School's running back, now they had this star running back, wound up playing for Ohio State, comes around the end, boom, down there, 6-0. Hamilton's leading us. They go to kick the field goal, they miss it. We go into halftime, we're down 6-0. Hey, we're pretty excited about 6-0. You know, we got beat 31-0 in 15 minutes. We're thinking, hey, we can walk out with, even if we go out 6-0, we won, we feel like we won. So, our coach gives us a speech, you know, one of those don't give up, come on guys, you know, drive to the end. I can't tell you what he said, but, you know, I'm sure that's what it was. We go out second half, third quarter, nobody scores. Fourth quarter comes up, one of our running backs breaks out, scores a touchdown. It's 6-6 now. And we're excited. Kick the field goal. We're ahead, 7-6 now. There's still 10 minutes left to go in the fourth quarter. So, at the end of the game, you look at that scoreboard up there, and you see home, which Raleigh, that was us, we're playing at our home field, 7. Hamilton High School, 6. We had beat the team that had beaten us 31-0 in 15 minutes because we didn't give up. We kept driving forward, and we finished strong. All right, our last slide here. Next slide. Push to the finish line with all the strength God has given us. And this comes from Judges 16:29-30. Samson put his hand on the two center pillars that held up the temple. Pushed against them with both hands, he prayed, "Let me die with the Philistines." And the temple crashed down. Samson did his greatest work at the end of his life. The Lord stayed with him the whole time, and he stayed true to the Lord. The Lord gave him the strength when he cried out for it. And that's what we have to do. We have to quit thinking we can take care of it ourselves and just cry out to the Lord that we need help. We need strength. Give up, never give up, and finish strong. Now let's go to our application slide. All right, if you're feeling exhausted, ask Jesus to strengthen you and carry you on, just like Samson did. And it doesn't have to be anything elaborate. Just, "Lord, I'm at my end. I can't do it. Please take control. Pick me up, carry me." The second point, refuse to give up. Samson didn't give up. They had him in chains, had his eyes gouged out, and he refused to give up. He fought through it there, and he did his greatest work at the end of his life. And I'd like to take a minute here, and let's everybody bow your head. Let's pray. And if you've had a time when you feel like that you just wanted to give up, couldn't go on, I ask you just raise your hand now and tell the Lord, "I need you, Lord. I need you." You can put them down after you raise them. Thank you very much. Lord, I know that you strengthen us each and every day. And we thank you for loving us and walking with us and giving us that strength. Lord, help us to keep focused on that finish line and drive forward. And Lord, we thank you for your son Jesus, who didn't say it was too much and walk away. He stayed true. He finished strong. and turned it over to you. And so in your Son Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Was it? Oh, sure is. Sorry. We have one more video. It's from the Logansport launch last week. I actually forgot all about that. So if you guys would.
Be a lunch at the Sandy Acres Park at 1:30.